Hello, everybody. This is Jughead, and you're listening and kind of watching from YouTube. I have recently started moving my archives onto my YouTube channel for any audiences that choose to use that form instead of the podcast form, which I condone. I do want to say that there isn't really much to the videos. It's just pictures I pull from the internet so that it makes it easier to post audio. I might change that sometime in the future and start posting the actual interview videos that I've been doing the last 2 years. But those right now just go to the Patreons, which leads me to shortly ask you to visit www.jugheadsbasementpodcast.com and become a patron at the $2, $5, or $10 tiers, which means you get the interviews that are done unedited and in video form from the Patreon site, and you get them advanced before the audio podcast audience gets them. If you can't do that, please share the podcast or the YouTube videos. Donate to Jughead's Basement, a one-time thing, at jugheadsbasement@gmail.com, and you can do that through PayPal. Otherwise, what I'll have to say about this episode is, my God, I had a couple few interviews right in a row, or episodes right in a row. Adrenaline OD, Angry Samoans, and Crimshrine, where I had almost all the members participate. And they were like the top three of my favorite punk bands of all time. So I'm really excited to get these back up on, to get these up on YouTube. I'll say that this is episode 13 of Angry Samoans Back from Samoa, and I originally published it on the 11th of August, 2014. At 7 p.m. Enjoy. Mike, what was part of that quote that you wanted to start the podcast with?
I would ask anyone who cannot endure to have heard what everybody nowadays thinks and feels to remember a well-known sentence of St. Jerome's. Quote, if an offense come out of the truth, better it is that the offense come that the truth be concealed. Thomas Hardy, 1895. But then you say, are you saying that the Back from Samoa album is a metaphor?
Are you saying, then, that the Back from Samoa record is a metaphor?
Everything in this whole world is a metaphor, man, and I am so over it. I firmly believe, however, that our creative work in the Angry Samoans, for lack of a better word, was completely and consistently non-metaphorical. The cuss words meant exactly what they always mean.
Welcome to episode 13 of Jughead's Basement, featuring the Angry Samoans' 1982 second full-length release of Back from Samoa, originally released on Bad Trip and Triple X Records. Right now, you're listening to Get Off the Air, released on their first studio album, Inside My Brain. The Angry Samoans formed in Los Angeles in 1978, directly imported from the short-lived band Vom, formed by three music critics, including rock author Notorious Aggravator, Richard Meltzer, alongside Gregg Turner from Cream Magazine, and Metal Mike Saunders, who acquired his name from being the first critic credited for applying the word heavy metal to the hard rock genre in the pages of Rolling Stone. The Angry Samoans have released four records and four EPs. The band's co-founder Gregg Turner left the Samoans in 1992. Mike Saunders and drummer Billy have continued playing shows to present day. The Angry Samoans were instrumental in continuing at where classic rock had begun to lose its way. They were crucial in punk's subversive dedication to sustaining the irreverence of rock music. And as always, the podcast will be presented to you in order of the songs as they appear on Back from Samoa, interspersed with sections of interviews of all Angry Samoans band members appearing on Back from Samoa, including singer-songwriters Metal Mike Saunders and Gregg Turner, bassist Todd Homer, drummer Billy Vockeroth, along with interviews by short-term guitarist and vocalist Jeff Dahl. The podcast also contains short interview essays by Samoan guitarist PJ Galligan, along with a written audio piece by Jughead's Basement regular Eric T. Roth. Footnotes. Since many of the Samoan songs are so short, I found it more aesthetically pleasing to leave some of the songs untouched by overdubbed interviews and only proceed or follow them up with commentary and oral history. And lastly, it must be stated that PJ Galligan, who, unable to speak because of his spreading cancer, contributed a written history of himself and his affiliation with the Angry Samoans. These pieces are read by voiceover actor Beauregard Marie. I must further state that in May of this year, PJ passed away from cancer. I thought long and hard about including these pieces, and made my decision to do so when I was contacted by his friend and partner, Alice, who informed me that he was very much looking forward to participating on the podcast. So at the end of the day, it was decided to honor him, and yet still try to maintain the integrity of the oral history of the Angry Samoans. And now I am proud to present the Angry Samoans Back from Samoa.
I was really thrilled that the album got finished. The mastering was great. We got legit pressings. We got nice sounding pressings. And the album hangs together. First four songs, yeah. Gas Chamber, Todd Killings, Lights Out, My Amen to Fetsa. Nice start to the album. Tight. That's like four songs in four fucking minutes. Legit. 5 minutes, Tom. No, 4 minutes. Four songs in 4 minutes. 5 minutes. Not four songs in four and a half. Then you go, Ballad of Jerry Curl, and they say it's this cock, not of the surf. That is a perfect seven song side. Then you go Steak Knife into, guess what? Homosexual. Steak Knife ends on a B. No, Steak Knife ends on an A chord. Homosexual starts on a B. Jackpot. Then you got the three short songs. Then you got to run A Better Time Has Come Today into a double time, really fast, way shorter, Hazen Friend Is Calling. And then here's what you're missing is one more great song. Like, how many albums actually close with a great song, like a bookend? Like the first movie, Grapes or something, or like some Beatles album. We can't remember. So the album's an 8.5. So Gas Chamber was written in 73. So it's, of course, it's about inside my head, this or that. It's a Stooges reference, a Stooges type lyrical reference. They just never put one to record, but they would talk about it in the Rolling Stone story in 1970, where this dork called Eric Erickman followed around and basically just rolled tape and transcribed it verbatim without any critical commentary. Hey, you gonna score some girls after the gig? He's really, really, really young.
From Vom, which supposedly means vomit, to Angry Samoans, is there a logical transition or a theme in choosing those names?
Richard came up with Vom. I forgot what other names we had. For the Samoans, I was always a big wrestling fan. I mean, wrestling back then, now it's a pathetic joke. But back in the days of Freddie Blassie and John Tolos and that kind of stuff, it was great. And there was this tag team called the Wild Samoans. And bad guys, which you had to be to, you know, gain my respect. So that stuck in my mind. And then, so initially, rather than just repeat the name Wild Samoans, I think I had put forward the idea of Big Fat Ugly Samoans. Somehow that, at the time, made sense to me as a name. So we morphed it around, and my friend, who was sort of a consultant to the band, says, why Big Fat Ugly? Just how about Angry? Because they're always angry. I said, are they? He goes, yeah. So that was it.
If we wound up writing a piece of literature, then I guess we did. We have no fucking idea. But obviously, like all the West Coast punk bands, many of them, we decided short songs are hella cool. Of course, the Ramones are the guys who reintroduced that for the first time since like 1964. That was so long overdue. This is a great pop song, or a mid-tempo kind of thing. I always hated it when people said, oh, 3 minute song. Dude, 3 minutes is a long fucking time to listen to a song. I got 3 fucking minutes.
Gregg, where were you born and raised?
Born in L.A., raised in L.A.
You are a pure L.A. bred man.
I guess that's my pedigree.
Bill, where were you born and raised?
I was born in Glendale, California, and raised in a town called, well, I called it Three Points, because I was raised in a town like Highland Park area in northeast Los Angeles, and then right around the corner of the East L.A., like another town called El Sereno, then there was South Pasadena. I kind of hung out in all three of those towns.
I just want to know, there's some basic questions first just about you, Mike, and so you can say what you want, but I just want to know first just where were you born and raised?
Me and my brother, who put the band together, me on a drum kit, him over with the guitar amp, at 14922 Bassett Street, Van Nuys, summer of 1978. We're born 4 years apart to the day, May 1st, 52 and 56. We were born on Chester Street in Little Rock, Arkansas, and we moved out to the far edge of town then in summer 1960 before my fourth grade and whatever the fuck he was doing at age four. So we're 4 years apart, me and Kevin Saunders on the first year of the band. Condi met in Van Nuys, California, summer of 78. Every lie in the book. The girls are hot. Oh, my God, it's the valley. The beach is 10 minutes away. It'll take you an hour. You'll love it. You'll be attacked with a hippie with a tire iron in a parking lot, and you and Todd will get your Datsun stolen at gunpoint outside Base of Sol at a Rubber City Rebels gig. You will bail within 1 year to go to grad school econ at Cornell University. But he came out there, packaged, like Christmas, with a free PA. Our band, all we had to do is find a garage, out the Turner Garage, 4857 Beeman. We're a garage band. Look at our photo in Rock Scene magazine. And wait, this guy's wearing a Boyster Cult t-shirt. These guys are rock critics. It's just because we had two. It's like that was unusual. It's a plot. They think they're smarter than everyone else. Of course they think they're smarter. They have more records.
Todd, where were you born and raised?
I was born in Long Beach, California. Raised in West L.A., basically. Went to the Beverly Hills school system. I have a twin sister and an older brother. And I think the first record I ever had was the soundtrack to Easy Rider, which, of course, featured Hendrix and Jefferson Airplane and stuff like that. Born to be wild.
Second track is the Todd Killings.
There was a poster that I got in, again, a sleazy movie memorabilia shop on Hollywood Boulevard, and there was this movie pile called The Todd Killings, and Todd and I always liked that, especially since his name was involved. So it just devolved out of that.
The fact that both Metal Mike Saunders and Gregg Turner were both critics for magazines such as Rolling Stone and Cream is very important to the understanding of Anger Samoans and the American punk rock scene during the late 70s. So here's a few interview bites from both Metal Mike and Gregg Turner. Gregg, did you come from a music or art-influenced background?
No, not at all. Just blue blood educators. My father was science superintendent in the LA City Schools, and my mom taught first and second grade.
You have a lot of different art influences. You know, you're a writer, and I'll actually call you a little bit of an actor, too. Where do you think your influences for actually picking up an instrument came from?
Well, first, I mean, I got involved, I think, musically, beyond, like, everybody just listening to the radio and friends and things like that. But I was a record collector. I was sort of an OCD, inveterate, hopelessly hooked record collector from, like, 1970 to 74 or 5. That's all I did. And I went around. There was a whole community of support group record collector fiends that went everywhere and anywhere for 45s and LPs. At one point, I had 40,000 45 RPM singles and about 30,000 LPs. I mean, it was hopeless. If there were medication to help it at the time, I would have taken some.
Did you have records that you never even listened to?
There were some I listened to just once and then filed them away, and there were others that I listened to consistently. But it's how I got to know a lot of obscure stuff and where I started appreciating it, I think. There's this guy, Fast Freddy, who now is a DJ in New York. And I started writing for Backdoor Man magazine, and it was 75-ish. And he was a record collector, too, so I knew him from that scene. That's where it sort of slid into being productive more aesthetically than just being a librarian.
Mike, tell us a little bit about the L.A. rock critic scene in the late 70s, early 80s.
Summer 71, I spent my 2-3 weeks out in California, first up in Marin County. Gregg Shaw boots me up and a former rock writer called Lita Olescu. She has a wall full of albums, one shelf, and it is long. It's a fucking 10-foot motherfucker of all her free records. So they have a party either at her place or someone's big backyard. I'm wearing my Jan and Dean Baylor Bandits t-shirt with a Grand Funk patch put on right dead center beneath Jan and Dean. Like, I'm multitasking, man. I dig New Girl in School. I also dig foot stomping music. You got a problem with that? We will talk. Greil Marcus is talking about Dylan and the band and Bob Dylan and the band and Bob Dylan and the band with Bob Dylan and Bob Dylan without the band. Not as pipey's talking serious shit to a couple guys. And I walk right up, and here's where it's hilarious. He knows who I am. I know who he is. And I say something that's like out of, you know, Teen Wasteland Gazetteville, like, you know, six words that are the stupidest shit you ever heard, and like stare at him, and he just gives me a look like, go away. Like, I'll give you $10, go away. So I go away. So I opted out of the Bob Dylan discussion group at Circle One. So the point is, that's rock critics at work, causing trouble, pissing people off.
What is Cream Magazine, Gregg, and how did you get involved in it?
Well, Cream Magazine was a pretty irreverent, in-your-face, making fun of things. It started as a fanzine and wound up to a pretty substantial, respectable circulation nationwide. And it was a rock and roll magazine. It basically covered all the national touring rock acts, British and American. And again, a very irreverent focus. They had LP reviews, they had feature interviews, very funny captions to photos that they would use. It wasn't Rolling Stone.
I've always wondered when, because I love the word irreverent for Cream Magazine, but was there still guidelines that you had to follow? Is it pretty much free reign?
It was pretty free reign. I mean, it depended on who you were writing about. I started writing for Cream after this initial fanzine Backdoor Man, because I met Richard Meltzer and this guy Billy Altman. He was the editor of the LP review section, and they liked what I had written for this fanzine Backdoor Man in Los Angeles for several years. So I slid into it that way. And they would give me a lot of the records that they knew were crap, and I was going to sort of, you know, turn the fangs and venom on them. They like that. Back then, you know, the record industry was paramount, and most writers, Stone and otherwise, got into the groove of, you know, praising anything just so they could get a whole stack of free promo records and show passes and things like that. And where I was coming from was like just the opposite. I couldn't care less. I had nothing to lose. And I did a review with Bon Jovi once that I called them like Putt Space number one, number two, and on down the line. And that got a lot of vitriol. And I did one of The Who, their record It's Hard, and it said something like, you know, middle age hit The Who like a ton of bricks. I'd rather listen to Tony Bennett. That got apparently just gargantuan amounts of hate mail, which they loved.
Did it ever affect your own ego to be sort of lambasted with bad press or mail that way? Or did it fuel you more?
Oh, no. It fueled me more. I mean, it was the fact that you were getting a reaction, and the fact that people were responding meant they actually were reading what you put down. I mean, so it was great. Again, Backdoor Man, which was the LA fanzine that I wrote for before Cream, was pretty much in your face insanity, making fun of people as well as praising things that we all liked at the time. With a purposeful grimace and a terrible sound, he pulls the spinning high tension wires
down. The band Vom, which supposedly is short for the word vomit, preceded Angry Samoans and was started by you, Gregg Turner, and a man named Richard Meltzer. Please tell us about the genesis of Vom and how it transitioned into the Angry Samoans.
Again, that came about when Meltzer had moved to L.A., and he was a pretty famous rock scribe, along with Lester Bangs, and talk about irreverent, he was the king. And he moved to L.A., and we all sort of, there were several of us that hung out together, including Saunders, who wound up with me in the Samoans. And basically it was a celebration of the dictators.
Oh, baby, you and me can go. I'm cruising everywhere we know. We'll take a trip out to the west. You know the coast the most because the coast is the best. I live for
New York City, soon to be punk heavy metal band. They were the first sort of comedy rock, loud, in your face group of knuckleheads that did that kind of thing. And we just thought they were just the best. And Meltzer came with all sorts of stories about them. And it was sort of like a, you know, small group of people that were ranting and raving about this new phenomenon from New York. After we hung out for a while, over a period of a year or so, Meltzer and I went to, it was the Variety Arts Center downtown L.A. and saw the Weirdos play. And Richard was out of his mind then and started pogoing up and down. Look, look, I can do it too. It's great. And that was the beginning of VOM. I mean, it was like, I can do it too. Came into the umbrella of, like, that's what punk rock should be about. Anyone can do it. This is, you know, a revitalization of what the music should have been going 8 years ago and turned into some bloated, horrible mess. So that was the genesis. And then we sat down and started trying to write songs, which was, you know, an uphill battle. And then lyrics, and we also wrote something called Electrocute Your Cock, looking for a hand job, stick it in a clock. You know, and I'm in love with your mom, God save the whales. It just got worse and worse and worse. And we were just having a great time. We didn't care whether people liked it or not, whether it was funny or not. We thought it was funny, so that's, again, all that mattered. Saunders came into the mix, and the three of us pretty much recruited some other people eventually that became the band, but the three of us were the nucleus that started putting the songs together. And that was VOM. I mean, VOM was the only band. I'm used to, so I say this, I'm 58 now, so I should know better even to mention it, but we had these things, bronco worms. They're called bronco worms because they would jump off the ground several feet, and there were sheep eyeballs, and we had a song called I Live With The Roaches. We couldn't get cockroaches in any quantity that we needed, toss them out of the crowd, so we got crickets instead. And we had barbed wire at the front of the stage immediately, so people got crazy in terms of trying to figure out what that was about, what they were supposed, how they were supposed to respond. So it just became a free-for-all. We'd start playing these songs. Our guitarist would always knock his guitar so out of tune that it was dissonant and horrible to hear. Meltzer wrote the lyrics to the song Harvester of Eyes for Blue Oyster Cult, so he thought that was funny and put these lamb eyeballs on his buttons on his coat, you know, and started pointing to them when he was singing, you know, the whatever eye song that we had, and throwing shit back and forth to the audience, and just became a free-for-all. It was less an excuse to play music than it was just to have a wrestling match. And it lasted about 76 to about 78, and Richard got exhausted. And just that's it. And then Saunders and I sort of looked at each other and thought, this was too much fun just to let it go. I mean, we may have sucked, but let's keep going. Let's do something funny.
Track 3, Lights Out.
Gregg, did you ever feel that the attitude and appearance of Angry Samoans confused your own peers and audience?
At first it did. I mean, I think, you know, again, you got to consider the context. When we started, punk rock again was just sort of taking off. There were the standard things that were just gaining some sort of momentum, like Patti Smith, like the Ramones, the Dictators were in New York. But the whole impetus of the Samoans in the beginning was just, we had an idea of what we wanted to do, but the first shows we played were just out of control and, you know, a continuation of VOM. I mean, we just were having fun entertaining ourselves. In fact, there was never any sense that we were going to become popular or caring about being popular. That wasn't the point. It was just sort of doing our stuff, and friends that would show up, maybe all 8 of them, you know, if they had a good time, great. If not, great. There was never any sense of destiny at all. And then when it started taking off, it took us completely by surprise. I mean, there was this club called The Channel in Boston that flew us out. We didn't even know we were headlining. And there was like 2,000 kids that knew every syllable of every word of every song. In fact, when we launched into Lights Out, our Poke Your Eyes Out anthem, there were these kids in the front with white plastic forks who were doing mock eyeball impalement gestures. I mean, like, Jesus Christ.
Bill, from what I can tell, you are not credited for writing songs from back from Samoa or other records, as you had said. But did you have much say in writing of your drum parts for the LPs?
On the first one, no. The second one, which was back from Samoa, was I got to do anything I wanted to, which was really fun because I always had an argument. I have to listen to this when I'm older.
Was there a big difference between the first and the second? That's Inside My Brain?
Well, yeah, the first album was kind of, this was kind of basic, and they just wanted a basic punk rock sound. Back from Samoa, I got to do anything I want, and the guy that was putting the record out first, he was a drummer, and he liked the drums, so he was, like, influenced me to play more drums, do more drums, which, at the time, is just like, you know, hey, just hit the snare drum. So it was a lot of fun, and back from Samoa, I had a great time.
That's probably one of the reasons, too, that record really sticks out to me. A lot of people's, that I know, favorite song is Lights Out. It's short, and the drumming, I think, is just great in that.
Yeah, it's mostly drums. It's the song, if you think about it.
There's nothing more you can leave behind, so forget about seeing, get into your mind. Everything looks better when the world's black. Grab a fork, make your first attack. Lights out!
Now here is the first of three pieces written by PJ Galligan and performed by Beauregard Marie. Before this piece, you will hear from both Todd and Gregg.
Todd, was there ever arguments about, I think there probably were, about direction of the band or battles over wanting to be taken more seriously? I ask this question because it seems like this band, particularly even the time period where this sort of motivated even the videos to some sort of recognition, but there's also sort of a self-destroying element to it too. So I just didn't know if there was battles over what the Angry Samoans were, like, to be taken seriously, or was it just for the fun of it?
No, it was a group effort and a group entity, you know. It was there was no conflict, you know, artistically. I mean, the most temperamental person was Metal Mike. He always seemed to have a skewed idea of the way things should be, and often it would rub Gregg and I wrong. Bill wouldn't bother, the drummer wouldn't bother to get involved in these kinds of arguments about the creative aspect of the band or the direction of the band and so forth. The guitar players, we call them the first stun guitar players, because we didn't actually have a lead guitar player per se, but we always had one guy that was an incredibly strong rhythm player. So Mike wouldn't have to play rhythm full time, and Gregg wasn't the strongest guitar player in the band. The band really had its strength with PJ Galligan, and he deserves credit for being one of the most amazing rhythm guitar players I've ever had the fortune to play with, and let alone hear.
Yeah, PJ was a nut. It's sad what happened. I didn't know about it until a few weeks ago, and apparently he died on the day, on May 1st, which was ironically Saunders' birthday. Mike's brother was in the band. He was one of the original members and then moved away, and then we had to replace him. And so there were a number of people that we had bumped into, but there was this band, ironically, as I remember now as I'm talking, in Ventura, California, called The Tumors. And The Tumors played with us on a show when we played Camarillo Mental Hospital. We played the Looney Bin about three times in different incarnations. It was just great. I mean, the kids would, like, bang their heads into the ground. They were required to wear helmets because of that. They're just a totally unimprovised, visceral reaction from these kids who are just jumping up and down. And although Mike was looking a little worried, this is great, but I should get out of here pretty quick. So PJ was in The Tumors. He was really good, and we kept in touch with him. And then when Kevin left, it just seemed like the next logical thing to do is to audition him, and he worked out great. I mean, he was just perfect for not just what we were doing, but playing real fast and morphing. I mean, back then when you play fast, there was no roadmap for that. He was perfect for that. I mean, there's nothing he wouldn't do or couldn't adapt to in terms of just playing along with whatever the next step was. So he was great in that respect.
I was born in the final year of the first Eisenhower administration.
Oh,
parents who were civil servants employed by the state of California. We lived at various addresses around the San Diego area before my dad was transferred to the Los Angeles office of his department. This early uprooting clearly damaged my subconscious forever and led me to play punk music in later life. 20, 24 hours ago, I want to be sedated. In LA, we also moved around for several years, living serially in houses that had been condemned by the state. That sounds bad, but they were actually fine homes that had been marked for destruction and replacement by freeways. No doubt it was the deep trauma of realizing that people would someday be driving where I slept as a child that eventually turned me into a punk guitar player. The promotion and transfer that my dad really wanted came his way when I was about 10, fifth grade, and living in a noisy two-bedroom apartment above Glen Oaks Boulevard in Glendale. This wasn't a state rental house, just a really temporary arrangement prior to moving to Ventura, a SoCal beach town usually referred to as north of LA, but actually almost due west. Obviously, my psyche was irreparably wounded by being forcibly removed from my preferred urban environment and plopped down in the vast seaside suburban wasteland. Surely this was the vital and evil trigger that led me forever astray, and almost directly to the angry Samoans. As the many severe impacts upon my troubled childhood had taken their toll, I had begun to exhibit the nefarious characteristics that we know today result in the vile punk side syndrome. I was truant, began using drugs, and, much later, beer. Got transferred to a continuation high school for dopers, troublemakers, and pregnant girls. I was 2 out of 3. And worst of all, became proficient in the operation of Satan's own instrument, the guitar. My dad died during junior year, and that demise of the nuclear family is probably a likely point as any to cease yap about being raised.
Mike Saunders wrote, "My Old Man's a Fatso," but I really couldn't get any information out of him about the song. What do you recall from it, Gregg?
Oh, you know, I remember, that was one of Mike's songs about his dad. And the thing I remember as being sort of funny was that when the dad finally died, it seemed he got self-conscious and guilty about it, so he wouldn't play that for 6 months afterward. Now, that's filtered through decades of, clarity, but it's sort of my recollection.
Bill, it looks like you have been the drummer from the beginning of Angry Samoans. Who from the band did you meet first, and how did this evolve into you being in the band Angry Samoans?
I met Metal Mike first on the phone. They had this paper out here they called Recycler. A lot of bands came out of that. It was like a free magazine. And I was really tired of the neighborhoods I was playing in. I saw this big practice out in North Hollywood, or Studio City, which was a ways away west of where I lived. And I thought, I could get in this band. It said in the ad, Mike claims that his brother or sibling put it in there, but it said fast and loud drummer needed for band. I didn't say what kind of band or anything like that. So I figured every band I was in, he'd complain I was too loud or too fast. This should be perfect. And so I met Mike first. Gregg Turner was there, but he wasn't doing anything. And I guess Mike's sibling was there. I think Todd Homer just finished doing his audition.
Sometimes you have like a band of like 3 people already, and they're just auditioning a guitarist or drummer, but it sounds like there are at least 2 that were auditioned, right? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. I think it was me and Todd were auditioned, and Todd got in there before me. And when I got there, Mike was playing drums, so Mike plays drums also. When I drove up with my friend, I heard them playing, and they were already playing a song. I was like, oh, I must have already found a drummer. And this guy knows the songs, he even knows when the breaks are, and wow. And I was going to leave, and my friend said, no, I'm still in there. This guy didn't sound that good. So I went in, it was Mike on drums, and he showed me a couple of songs real quick, and then he said, ask me if I could do them. I said, sure, it's easy.
So the style that they needed, you were already, it was pretty simple for you to pick up.
Yeah. It's pretty simple, and like I said, with Mike playing drums too, it was easy to see what they kind of wanted, and then I said, oh, that's pretty much what I was into, playing fast and goofing around, not hitting the cymbals that much.
Were you actually called up, or did they just right there say, all right, you're in?
Yeah, pretty much said, all right, you're in. We do want to be in the band. And they had the, I was pretty impressed because Mike had a drum set there already, so I didn't have to bring a drum set to rehearsal. They handed me a 45, which is the bomb 45. I thought that was a big deal. None of my friends had a 45 out. Yeah, so they gave me one of those, and I was all impressed. Like, ooh, this band's going somewhere. So I listened to it. They still play it out on the radio. No way.
Did you actually have that realization then?
Oh, yeah. So that's a big joke, I guess, with the band name, too. You know, we didn't be playing this long for one. I think this is my 36th year in the band.
If I'm not mistaken, Todd, both you and Billy auditioned for the band. How did this audition go down, and how did you end up in the band?
By August of 1978, I'd already spent about a year in and out of various bands that looked like they were going nowhere. So by now I had a little bit of recording experience, a little bit of live performance experience. And I put an ad in the Recycler and said, socially depraved bassist seeks others. Phone number was 818 area code, ending in 1966. And Metal Mike phones me and says, it's a great number there, 1966, you know. That was the best year for rock and roll records, by the way, and starts listing out. I go, hey, look, dude, what the hell did you want from me? Really, very strange right off the bat. Well, my brother's in town, he goes on, and we're going to start a rock and roll band. So I said, look, I only want to do a punk rock at this point. And he said, okay, but that's what we're going to do. We already broke up a punk band, and that turned out to be Vom. So I was invited over to a garage on a Saturday. I drove into the alley behind the garage, and I heard, didn't know what I was hearing, except it sounded like Ritchie Blackmore. I heard wailing guitar, cheesy heavy metal guitar. So I took my foot off the brake and I drove out of there. You know, I stopped and got a cheeseburger, and before I got home, I just turned around and said, fuck it, I got nothing else to do today. So I went back to the garage. And by this time, Billy had already showed up. Mike was schooling him on how to play the drums, Metal Mike way. Mike was a pretty good drummer in his own right in those days. And there seemed to be a lot of hair in the room, a lot of people with long hair. That kind of bugged me. And they never got around to me playing. They had already decided that Joe Besser, a neighborhood friend of Greg's, was going to be the manager of the group. I could hear Besser arguing with Kevin, Mike's brother, that I hadn't been auditioned. And Besser screaming, he's in the band. And just based on appearances. And Kevin said, but we don't know if he can play. And Besser screaming, who gives a shit? So I said goodbye and was soon invited to a garage. And then suddenly I was in a garage band.
Track number 5 is Time Has Come Today, which was originally released in 1966 by the Chambers Brothers, and also covered 1 year later after you guys covered it by the Ramones in 1983. Gregg, please tell me why you covered Time Has Come Today and even made a video of it.
Time has come today!
Yeah, it was just a great song, and we were pleased. I mean, we wild shot into the dark. Maybe Joe Chambers, the original, you know, writer and performer in the band, would actually like to give his try at a punk rock moment, and sure enough, he did. We just thought we used to do pictures of Matchstick Man also, and so our heart and soul was in a lot of the really punky for the time '60s punk rock stuff.
You know, Gregg had talked about that you had you two had seen, I think, Rocky Erickson.
Palomino.
I have to roam. I've got no home.
The real driving force of the Angry Samoans for Saunders and I was Rocky Erickson. He was just spectacular. Talk about a Looney Tune, and at the same time, the genius ability to transform everything that he touched into some crazy shit. And Saunders and I were huge fans of the 13th floor elevators.
Is this the 13th floor? Must have the wrong elevator. No, you're not on the wrong elevator. That's an intro if you ever heard one. You're gonna miss me, the 13th floor elevator.
The elevators were something back then that not a lot of people knew about. I mean, it somehow it caught up to the world way later on. But at that point, it was pretty obscure. And even Rocky, as a solo artist, coming to the light of day after he was incarcerated at the mental institution for several years, was, again, a pretty well-kept secret. And Saunders and I were completely plugged into that. So most of the stuff in the early days that we did with the Samoans, that was the model. Be eccentric and crazy if you could, and the stripe of the vitriol or the stripe of the angst was pretty much modeled after watching Rocky play.
Palomino.
The most transformational moment I've ever had at a music showing is when Rocky came to the light of day in 1975. I have all these stories that I've heard, being a huge Elevators fan, played the Palomino Club in North Hollywood, which was a downtrodden country and western club in the San Fernando Valley.
Palomino. 75 before I moved back to Arkansas. Palomino was a good gig. Four songs. I had a cassette tape of it forever. Doug Somm got him out. He did Starry Eyes. He did You're Gonna Miss Me. And he did Probably Don't Shake Me, Lucifer. The Doug Somm band was backing them up, but they didn't get in the way. They stayed out of the way. So Rocky was definitely playing guitar without the fake volume control. Make him think he was loud when he wasn't.
And no one knew who Rocky was. The rumor was getting around that the singer of the 13th Floor Elevators was playing the Palomino Club, where he's stepping in for a song or two. And no one believed it, but I had a couple friends. I said, we've got to check this out just in case. And go down there wearing our Elevators t-shirts that we had made. I have our records with us for an autograph. And sure enough, there he is, this scruffy guy, explains to this woman on the table how he knows, in fact, that he's an alien from Mars. And he goes, my mom was the first one, man, that told me I was an alien. And she's going, yeah, we're waiting just for this to finish to talk to him, but we're watching this transcript. Since my mom was the first one that told me, how do you spell Ma? She goes, M-A. He goes, right, and he writes it down on the table in this dark cell pen. Now, what's the letter of my first name? She goes, Rocky, that's R. Now they add an R to it. And what comes in the alphabet after R? She's S. And then now he has M-A-R-S and underlines it 80 times. He goes, I couldn't believe either the first time I found out. And we're looking at each other going, oh my God, I guess it's true. All the stories we've heard. You know, Sam is doing his R&B stick, and he's, I'd like to introduce a friend of mine, come along for the ride. Please welcome Rocky Erickson. And our jaws drop, like, what's this going to be? And Rocky goes to all the amps on stage and turns them up to 12. And hits the first chords of You're Gonna Miss Me and starts screaming, I mean shrieking, like just on the record. And it was the most transformational moment I've ever seen, with all these guys who came to see Song, who was a good old boy Texan, just their jaws dropped, like, holy shit. And he went on to do all these songs, amazing performances, incredible voice, but just psychopathic. That was it. I thought, this is the real thing. This is the first thing I've ever had a feeling of, where it's completely out of control, taking on a life of its own in front of your face and watching this go down. That just fueled the fire for me completely in terms of, okay, this is what I want it to be. This is what I want. If I do anything musically, I want it to be out of control, this much in your face in terms of the passion and the sense of urgency of it. Of course, designing that on your own is different than just having it by default, like Rocky.
Right before the podcast of the Angry Samoans was to be finished, I finally got a hold of Jeff Dahl, who was living in Hawaii. Jeff was kind enough to talk to me for a while a hurricane was hitting his house. Now that is hardcore. He was the singer during Metal Mike's absence. Here is Gregg talking about Jeff Dahl, and then you'll hear from Jeff Dahl himself.
Jeff was great. Jeff's one of my best friends in the world. He's a great guy. It didn't work out for a number of reasons, just because the eccentricity, let's put it that way, of Saunders, the band was so rooted in that and the songs and the personality integrated into all of that, that it was hard to shake off. That Jeff's take was more, I think, you know, being punk rock by way of Jim Morrison and Iggy, and he did a great, great job doing that, of course, adding his shtick too. But what this wasn't the same. But on the other hand, it was sort of more of a cartoon caricature of bringing our songs to life. in that period when Jeff was with the band, that's when we really started getting popular. It just, at the time Mike quit to go back to the Bay Area to be an accountant up there, threw in the towel. We hadn't gained any following, really. I mean, the record hadn't come out yet, so there wasn't any big deal. We were playing more frequently with Jeff, gaining more of an audience quickly. So we were really starting to gain momentum the minute he joined the band. And I think by the time Saunders eventually came back, we were up at the next level before when he left. Jeff contributed a huge amount. I mean, it's unclear in my mind that if it hadn't been for Jeff, if we would have evolved to the next level.
Where were you born and raised, Jeff?
Well, kind of classic military brat situation. My dad was in the military, and my mom worked for the State Department. And we did a lot of moving around. I was born in Germany, actually, Stuttgart, Germany. The first 4 years of my life, we probably lived in about 10 or 12 different countries. I wish I still had my infant passport to kind of see all the different places. Germany, Moscow, Paris, a couple of different places in the U.S., Maryland, Fort Ord, California. Then we kind of went out to the Southeast Asia area, Australia, and the Philippines. My parents split up when I was about four and a half years old, and we were in the Philippines. So my mom took me and my brother and came to Hawaii. That's where I was raised. I did all my schooling and, whatever it is I learned it here.
What brought you to L.A.?
After high school and everything, I joined the Army. And I was in for 3 years, mainly stationed in the Washington, D.C. area at the Pentagon heliport. After I got out, you know, I went for a year, took a year at the University of Hawaii. That was like when the beginning of punk rock was just starting. And, it was, okay, well, I want to be part of this, so where do I go? And L.A. was the closest spot that looked like they had a good scene. So, packed my bags and took off for Hollywood.
Who did you meet first in the Angry Samoans, and how did this end up with you joining the band?
With the Angry Samoans, I knew who they were first because I was like a, like a real... a big reader of Cream magazine. So I knew that Gregg and Metal Mike both wrote for Cream, and they also wrote for Bagger Man, which is like one of the best magazines there ever was. I knew who they were first. What happened is we did a show at a place called Beyond Baroque in Venice Beach. The bill was the Mentors, the Angry Samoans, and my band Vox Pop. That's where I met the Samoans. I mean, Gregg was the first guy I kind of really made contact with and started talking to. Gregg Turner was the first guy that from the Samoans that I really got in contact with. At that first show, Gregg had told me that Mike was getting ready to move up to San Francisco and he wasn't going to be in the band anymore, so they needed they were looking for a new singer. They tried a bunch of guys out and couldn't find anyone that was remotely suitable for them. So I said, hey, what about me, man? So I raised my hand real quick, and really, I think a week or two afterwards, I did an audition, and they said, well, your hair's kind of long, but you're in.
Track number 6, They Saved Hitler's Cock. First, you will hear from Todd Homer, and then Gregg Turner, and finally, a Jughead's Basement regular, Eric T. Roth, discussing his relation to the Angry Samoans and They Saved Hitler's Cock.
Jeff Dahl and I wrote the music, Hitler's Cock, and I just used an unused lyric that was never going to be used anyway. I thought, let's not even bother writing music. Let's just take something that Gregg had pinned up on the wall. He had some lyrics just sitting on the wall of the house that we rented. And I lived with Gregg and another guy for some time in those years. And I was waiting for the opportunity to use these lyrics, They Say Hitler's Cock, but when Jeff was trying to play Inagata Vida and fucking up the riff, I said, no, it's good, even though it's not right, at least it's original, and we'll run. So I finished the tune with him, and then we just grabbed the lyrics and put it together.
Track 6, They Saved Hitler's Cock. That one actually has Jeff Dahl, so it must have been during that time period of writing.
But then I think Todd redid the vocal on that, I believe. There was this movie, They Saved Hitler's Brain, and I just thought, They Saved Hitler's Cock, that's even better.
They Saved Hitler's Cock is about my relationship with my father. Of course, it isn't. It's a song with a title directly referencing the 1969 TV movie They Saved Hitler's Brain, starring Walter Stocker and Audrey Claire.
Hitler alive. Incredible.
The song starts with some fascist drumming. And then you hear this Hitler dude, and he's sprechen the Deutsch like a Nazi. And the guitar comes in, and it's all kind of surfy, kind of whiny. You're like, oh man, maybe this is like a song about surf Nazis. And then the song sort of answers a series of questions. The first question is, what's up, dude? You look like you just had a fright. What's going on?
They saved Hitler's car.
What? How do you know this?
They hid it under a rock.
Oh. When do you have the time to go around digging up rocks?
I discovered it last night. I couldn't even believe my eyes. Hitler's cock could start.
The first time I heard the Angry Samoans was at this point in my life, about 14 years old, where my friends and I would mostly interact by screaming at each other and quoting things and screaming songs in each other's faces because we hadn't really had sex yet. And so one day my friend Nick and I were walking and he starts going,
"There's nothing more you can leave behind."
And suddenly I'm a fan of Angry Samoans. And we learn the song as a duet because we have a band. And so now we're walking down the street going,
"There's nothing more you can leave behind. So forget about C, get into your mind. Anything looks better when the world's flat. Grab a fork, make a first attack right now."
It was either that song or,
"Hey Jack, what's happening?"
"I don't know."
"Well, rumor around town says you might be thinking about going down to the show."
Yeah, I think I'm going to go down to the shore."
We would sit in Nick's dad's dingy basement with our friend Francis White behind his duct-taped drum set. Every weekend, we'd walk across the dusty lead paint floor, past the pool table, the old furniture and copies of National Geographic he couldn't throw away, and we'd play those songs ad nauseum. I loved Angry Samoans so much, I went out and bought an entirely different album.
STP, STP, I'd rather have you than that LSD.
STP, not LSD, served a high school Chicago summer break well. I'd walk to Nick's dad's from the Brown Line on Western Avenue, baking in my dress pants. Shorts were not an option because I needed to be as fucking miserable as possible, listening to the last track on the album.
"No, no, no. I need a place to stay. No, no, no."
A song you just can't help listening to when you're feeling like dog shit. I was fat. Pretty fat, kinda normal, but in a household run by a former gymnast who owned his own gymnastics school, whose family unit needed to appear healthy, I was fat. I had quit gymnastics before high school, suddenly hit puberty, and gained 40 pounds. This was not okay. My old man was not a fatso, neither was my mother. Though when I was a child, my mom had put on a few pounds, and my brother and I, inexhaustible in our vindictiveness, tested the waters during dinner. "You're fat." My father said nothing. "You're fat." Insulting my mother was a serious no-no, punishable by a mouth washed out with soap. But this night we were let loose, and we indulged in the freedom. "You're fat. You're fat. You're fat." My mother looked across the table at my father. They waited another 15 years before getting divorced. Puberty is a time of terror about your body, your voice, your face, your pimples, your dick, your vagina, your boobs, your dick, everyone else's dick, everyone else's vagina and boobs. The album Back from Samoa chronicles a bunch of dudes worried about dicks. The dicks of
homosexual
in Steak Knife. Then there's Jerry Curlane. Punk rock gives a soapbox to fucked up voices, and puberty fucks up your voice real bad. They Saved Hitler's Cock is about my father, whose penis I saw when I was a child. It was huge. My baby dick could not compare. I saved that in my memory for forever, for whatever reason. Call it Freudian, call it bad luck. The similarities between my father and Hitler are very limited. Closeted German ex-Jews with dicks. But you grow up, you think you've grown up. You're 18 years old, and it's late, and apparently tonight the music is too loud, and he's pissed. and he grabs you by the back of your neck and clumsily hurls you into the other room. And now you're pissed, and you're squared off. Chest out, and Mom is screaming, "Stop! Stop!" Just like he should have done when you were calling her fat in the exact same goddamn room. She's yelling, "Stop! Stop!" You don't deck him, but fuck, you could. And it'd be a fucking brawl. And he'd delight in calling the cops after you kicked his ass. And even though you didn't, you picture punching him in the stupid face for the rest of your life. You knock out his bad knee. The dining room chair would splinter in your hand as you smash in his head. That's the way it ends when your brain falls down that rabbit hole of anger and frustration. It ends with you winning instead of him taking everything you own and hurling it into the yard. Multiple trips up and down the stairs, empty drawers, rows of shelves outside on the lawn you shittily mow. Not the front yard, because the neighbors would see. And remember, even for Hitler, it was all about appearances. My father is not Hitler. Although maybe that night he was. And what if instead of sobbing and rubbing the mud off of all my books and records and CDs and my pillows and sheets and clothes, what if I killed Hitler? What of him would I save? They saved Napoleon's cock. The years have not done it well. It looks like a sliver of beef jerky. Rasputin's, on the other hand, looks like a big old yam you'd be happy to pick up for Thanksgiving. It'd feed the whole family, and then some. But I didn't kill Hitler that night. I got the fuck out of there. I screamed my old man's a fatso, and they saved Hitler's cock into Chicago's endless alleys and empty streets. I fell back behind music. Pulled down my headphones, shut out my thoughts, learned to misplace my anger, lost my sadness behind smiles and jokes and sex, fell in love, and out, and in, out, in, with bulging eyes. The devil's living in disguise. He's in this world. He's here today. He's been living in this lost highway.
Track number 7, Homosexual, is actually written as Jay Falwell.
Of all the stuff we've ever done, that's the one I'm sort of most embarrassed about. It certainly wasn't to be homo bashing, which a lot of people thought at the time, because Fear was really into that. The idea of our sense of how it was funny was to be this that was really confused and sort of in a circle as far as the singer trying to make sense of what's going on. But I think it just turned out just too vitriolic about a diatribe against people being gay. That wasn't the idea at all.
Saturday, March 13th, I go into Burano Studios once only. I sing My Old Man's a Fatso, Homosexual. There's no vocals on nothing. No guide vocals, no nothing. We rewrite the lyrics to Homosexual literally the night before when I get down because the lyrics are a mess. And, oh, gosh, in the Marin County session, Jeff is singing gibberish and Homosexual's like, oh, my God. No, you did not say that. Like, dude, the song is... Greg would explain, I tried to tell Jeff, the song should be like this and that and this and that. And Jeff would go, yeah, we hate queers. No, Jeff, we don't hate queers. Like, back up. Let's start again. It like, couldn't be fixed. So we lost some good lines. Brian Epstein was a queer. John Lennon, John fucked him up the rear. You know, we lost some good tracks.
In fact, we went out of our way putting the credit Jay Falwell on it just to make sure that wouldn't be the case. But people took it wrong.
Actually, I'm going to ask you very quickly, since some people may not know that. I think people growing up and watching TV then would know that. But who is Jerry Falwell, and why would that be attached to that?
Well, Jerry Falwell is like Pat Robertson. He was the religious right-wing extremist nut that constantly, preached that homosexuals are, the walking abortions of Jesus. It just seemed only right that, if there was any cred attached to this, what people perceived as the message of the song, he should be it.
Was there anything sacred for Angry Samoans?
In terms of targets?
Yeah.
No. anything was fair game. I mean, again, we had such disparate people involved as players in the band that it was never a consensus all the time as far as what we wanted to do or what we were going to do. The creative nucleus of the band was really me and Mike and Todd. So it was a lot of wrangling as far as how we wanted to go about offending people.
Todd, what is the crux of the Angry Samoans, and is there anything sacred that the band wouldn't have made fun of?
Yeah, making fun of things was the gist of it. Making fun of homosexuals and junkies and rock stars, those were like the three biggest enemies we had. Beyond that, it would be women and celebrities and other people in the scene. We did attack like Roddy Bingenheimer. We attacked Darby Crash even after he died, you know. You know, we would sometimes publicly call bands like X art school dropouts, things like that. And glitter faggots. There were a lot of, you know, post-glitter bands that were trying to make it as punk rockers suddenly, you know. There were a lot of horrible post-glitter bands around Hollywood that suddenly became punk rock bands around 1977, 78. But there's no actual politics. I mean, I'm talking about party politics. There's none of that whatsoever. I've never mentioned of Reagan and, you know, whatever else was going on in the country at the time. It was more about the scene. Self-hatred had a part of that.
I can't explain. Homosexual! We love you. Homosexual! Up the ass. Homosexual! Kirby Crash. Homosexual! Make it last.
Bill, in a time now where many stand-up comedians are being put on the spot and being called on pushing racial, sexual, and political issues too far, and many are trying to figure out how to stay on the edge to perhaps cause change or just to shock, how does Angry Samoans fit into this narrative? Have there been times when the band has been wrongly accused or misunderstood to the point of frustration, or was it just for fun?
Yeah, it was kind of when I was, you know, in the band, we were doing the songs, my friends would ask me about it. I'd say it's a joke band, you know. It's not really, I wouldn't really say it was hardcore punk. I'd just say it was a joke band and making poking fun at people or things, you know. But, you know, we're all, you know, it's like homosexual says, I'm one too, we love you. It's, you know, we have nothing against, or I don't have anything against homosexuals, or we're not culture stealers, you know. We're trying to steal the Samoan in name, you know, and you know, we were accused when the internet first came out that, you know, we have no culture. That's why we want to take the name of the Samoans. But I've met a lot of Samoans now. They're funny. They laugh at it. They want a shirt. They want to wear it. You know, but I didn't write the songs. I just played the drums. And some of them worked. Some of them, yeah, I was against some of the songs, you know. The Rodney song, I thought it was kind of silly, being that he was like the guy that you needed, being like playing in a top 40 group. You know, you want to go places. You don't want to just get yourself put really, really down, further away from getting to get shows or like that. And I was like, oh, why would you want to make fun of a guy? And then I used to go to some of the shows and see him, like, oh, it's kind of mean, making fun of poor Rodney. But people like it, and people, I don't know, they react to it still. We play it still anyway.
Yeah, I think it's, like I said, I'm one too that's been in a, you know, in a band for a long period of time with a very controversial singer who just likes to shock people. So I know the sort of walking that line. And
yeah, I didn't get too much heat from it, you know, not too bad. I've had friends like kids later in the 90s, you know, saying, you know, that were into punk rock. They dress all up with the chains and the boots and the handcuffs and all stuff and bondage pants. And they used to say, I tell anyone, you can ever come see, you know, my band. And they go, oh, my friends say you guys are racist. You guys are homophobes. And I said, oh, it's just silly songs, you know. You can't take that stuff serious.
The song Get Off the Air does not appear on Back from Samoa, but its story is integral to the lore of the Angry Samoans.
So here is Gregg and Metal Mike talking about the song Got Off the Air and Rodney on the Rock.
The thing that really took off, that bridged the Samoans from something that was just self-indulgent to something that all of a sudden people started plugging into, was the Rodney song.
You're a fucking piece of shit now, Rodney. I don't think you're
There's
so
a guy called Rodney Bingenheimer, who was this little Weasley groupie on the scene that was a shapeshifter in terms of anything that was he perceived as cool and popular.
Rodney Bingenheimer on KROQ.
Rodney on the Rock. Rodney on the Rock. He was an advocate. And glam rock was happening in the early 70s, and the Brits like Bowie were coming over, and Rod Stewart or whatever. Rodney was there with his English disco, and punk rock was big. All of a sudden, he was a punk rocker. And he was this groupie that wound up in L.A., somehow got in the position of having a radio show. And the Samoans also, besides just modeling things that he liked, like Rocky Erickson and stuff like that, always were complete, I can speak for Mike and myself anyway, our take was that we hated celebrity. We hated the whole Hollywood consecration and championing of some sort of iconship, of something, popularity, culture that should be worshipped and revered. That just made us sick to our stomach. So here is this guy, now in the context of punk rock with a radio show, with an IQ of about 45, you know, who's trying to promote himself as a DJ, getting on, he got all these people on his show. And, you know, you go, yeah, punk rock, here's Lenny Kaye, he's the bass player of Patti Smith. He wasn't. So, you know, this kind of stuff. And so we thought, someone's got to say something. So we wrote the song, Get Off the Air, about him. You know, he can't read and he can't talk. He's always favorite punk rock jock. You know, APM and Rodney's on the air. He's beating off in Joan Jett's hair. And we thought this was just hilarious, number one. And number two, we thought this is what punk rock should be, butting heads with establishment, which he, in our minds, sort of epitomized. We thought he'd just take the song and go, yeah, hey, they wrote a song about me. These guys hate my guts. This is cool. You know, instead of that, got completely horrified. I don't know why we wouldn't think that would be the case, but he banned us from every club in L.A. And then there were bands he was giving publicity to on this radio show, like X. Whole slew of others that took themselves very seriously as poets and as you know, artists, and just to us, the contrary of what should be the case for the so-called scene, they agreed that they would never play with us because of our assault on Rodney. Then we started getting attention in the local papers about the band that we, you know, had the song about him. His lawyer, Rodney's lawyer, was Jay Jenkins, this guy that also, not so surprisingly, managed the band X. So there's all this incest going on. So he used to send us a threatening letter saying, if you continue playing the song, you know, I'm going to sue you and take away all your equipment. And we took that letter that he wrote us and made it the band flyer for the next show. And this got building and building and building. We couldn't play anywhere in town because of this, so we had to go to the suburbs. I mean, like Whittier and Long Beach and all the places that were the skate shows were going on. And that was the genesis of hardcore. The punk rock was morphing into hardcore, where all these jocks and crazy assholes were cutting their hair and using it as an excuse to beat people up. It was just, it was the only place we could play. We weren't playing terribly fast like we wound up playing in the 80s. So we just sort of triple-timed everything so they wouldn't beat us up. We were playing faster, 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 and then we just got the nod that, hey, these guys are cool like the other bands. And suddenly, from that and the Rodney publicity, the sort of the Samoans were hatched to consciousness of other people. You're a fucking piece of shit now, Rodney. I don't think
you're so high. Rodney. Mike, tell us about your radio interview on Maximum Rock and Roll Radio, where you challenged Black Flag and Rodney on the Rock.
It was so persona non grata to even be seen on the same gig of ours. True story. Rodney had his flunkies call PJ and said, oh, hey, check it. Dig, if you guys never play at the Angry Samoans, we'll give you more radio time. They go, what? That's crazy shit. No. Yeah. Make sure not to play at the Angry Samoans. We'll give you extra radio time. That's how whack it was. So it was so persona non grata to even be seen in the same room as us. Black Flag's been interviewed on tour out in 81 with Henry Wild Dog. And so he says, what's the deal with like Angry Samoans and Rodney? And Chuck goes, ah, oh, they're lame. They can't get gigs, they suck. I see the fanzine. I take our chest bursting on the air. We play a couple songs, Gas Chamber and whatever, Homosexual. It's good out for all you queer homosexuals. And I say, Tim, yo, Jeff, listen up. Here's the Pepsi challenge. I challenge this band called Black Flag that we will play opening band anywhere in the state of California, pay your own gas money to play in the same bill as them. Guess what? It ain't going to happen. Guess why? Because they're chicken. Chicken, chicken, chicken. Bop, bop, bop. Because their head is up Rodney's ass. Truth. Just ask them. Get off the air. Get off the air. You pathetic male queer. You don't impress me. Get off the air. You fucking
Punk has always been known in a great part as having to do much of the business ourselves in order to survive. Besides drummer, what would you consider your role in the band over the years?
Well, in the beginning, I was just the drummer, just play drums, and I didn't sing, I didn't do anything like this. Play the drums, and I didn't book any shows or deal with anything. That came way later.
Did you find yourself like sort of a voyeur in your band? Were you fine with all the business? Was there like one or two people that were in charge of most of that?
Yeah, but there wasn't really that much business going on. You know, it was punk rock.
Yeah.
Play shows, we never got any money. I think it took like probably 11 years until we finally, you know, got some money from a show with, you know, on top of the expenses. Otherwise, it was just all expenses and, you know, paying for rehearsal out of our own pockets and traveling. Like when we travel, we pay for our plane tickets out of our own pockets. It was just more like a fun thing to do. It was all new. I mean, there wasn't that many punk bands around. It was pretty cool. You know, whole different new thing.
Gregg, tell us about track 8, Steak Knife.
Well, you know, there was a German hardcore record that came out called Ami Hardcore Best Of. We had like two or three of the tracks, and Steak Knife and its alter ego later on became known as Posh Boys Cock.
Posh Boys Cock! Posh Boys Cock! Fucking shit!
Yeah, you know, if you want to make a record, if you want to rock, grab a hold of the Posh Boys Cock, which apparently he didn't think was very funny. I'm told that was the same Steak Knife track with just different vocals substituted for it. When we wrote back from Samoa, you know, Mike and I would sit down and just laugh ourselves silly on the floor writing all this stuff. It was just, most of it, the writing process was mostly actually my song titles, and then song titles would really suggest, you know, the riff or the mentality of it or whatever. Then I would have lyrics, or he would have a riff, or he would do it the other way around, or sometimes he wrote the whole thing. We would always sit down and just crack up that this is so ridiculously idiotic and stupid that, you know, we're going to appeal to maybe 11 friends and the 12th is going to be precarious.
I'm on the rag. Think of my balls in a plastic bag. Think I need a doctor to look inside my head. Every time I love a girl, I stab her in my bed. I see my life in vision's crimson shape. I see my life in hell. There's no escape. There's a hole in the hole of my heart.
We had no idea. I mean, who in a million years you look on YouTube for, you know, just the sound wave download of Lights Out, and there's 250,000 hits. That was like, we thought that was like a cosmic joke.
Back in Samoa, we were recording it as early as 1981, and we had great lyrics in those days. And that's to Gregg's credit. He was writing some of the best lyrics that the band ever had. And that just lasted basically for the first two records. And then they weren't as full of all that charged hatred.
Here is part two of the story of PJ Galligan.
I was an editor of the school paper, the VC Press, at Ventura College. One semester, we got a new journalism student named Sandy LaFaro. We got to talking about music. She really liked terrible shit, like the Rolling Stones, and knew about some band called The Pop that was managed by some guy she knew named Gregg Turner. I heard The Pop once, another terrible band Sandy loved. She mentioned that this guy Turner had his own band and that he wanted them to play at Camarillo State Hospital. Now, it just so happened that I had this band called Tumors, which was an acronym for the Underground Manipulators of Rational Stupidity. We were kind of proto-punk, kind of metal, all fast stuff, mostly original for a change, with stage names and sort of a lunatic surgical lobotomy shtick that seemed like a good idea at the time. Another happenstance was that the bass player was my best friend and neighbor, Mark Foster, whose mom worked on one of the acute psych units at Camarillo State Hospital.
Oh, wow!
Baby! You're driving me crazy!
And there was was some back and forth, kind of long distance talking and arranging done over time at several points to work something out. Toomers thought playing at the Loony Bin was a good idea too. Foster's mom was the contact, and since I was sweet on Sandy, I figured it couldn't hurt to get her pop manager buddy's band in on the deal too. So, Foster's mom wrangled permission for us to play on the psych unit on a Saturday afternoon. As I recall, the Samoans played first, then stuck around to watch us. We all had fun, packed up and left, and that was that. Sometime after that, Toomers did a gig at Club 88 in L.A. that went really badly. Blew up in our faces, with everybody mad at everybody else, all pissed off and blame-throwing. And that was the end of that band. Not too long after that, I got a package in the mail from Metal Mike.
Right side of my mind.
Angry Samoan songs laid out on paper with lyrics and chord changes and a cassette tape or two to listen and learn from. I was being asked to join the band.
Right side!
Then I have number nine is...
Aislinn's Brain is Calling. So, again, Rocky Erickson connection. When Rocky was asked lots of times about the demons that he thought possessed him, he was always talking about Haseman's devil. And he had a picture in a book of demons, illustrated book of demons that in the 70s he would carry with him. And on this one page, it would describe Haseman's devil. And Haseman was a farmer who apparently betrayed some pact with the devil, and the devil made him vomit and eat the vomit up and vomit and eat the vomit up, according to Rocky. So we again thought this was just great. So we used that was Haseman's Brain is Calling. And then a lot, and our music was published by Haseman Music.
I love the album design, and it says it's done by Ron Spencer. So can you tell us a little bit about the cover of Back from Samoa?
Three steps and a shot of light. I see a blinding flash. Blood is dripping from my head, lying on my back. His brain is calling.
The other thing that, besides Rocky Erickson, that Mike and I loved were bad horror movies from the 50s. Corman stuff, The Attack of the Crab Monsters, Not of the Surfs, which wound up to be a song title, The Attack of the Mushroom People, Creature of the Black Lagoon, there's a whole series of those. The one that was the best was called Monster of Piedras Blancas.
The Monster of Piedras Blancas, the world's most shocking monster, stalks its unsuspecting prey, feasts its eyes on the next victim to writhe in its slimy eyes.
The creature monster goes into a mom-and-pop grocery market, and in each claw has its severed head, which is one of them, like on the album cover. It throws it onto the iceberg of romaine lettuce in the produce section, and the camera sort of dispassionately circles around it and looks at the heads. I thought, oh my God, if I ever do something creatively or whatever, I want this photo to be involved. And that was it.
A claw-fingered, scaly-skinned, half-human crustacean, turning a lonely lighthouse village into a frenzied bedlam of blood-curdling horror. See the movie named the most brain-paralyzing shock story of them all, The Monster of Piedras Blancas.
You know, back then, record stores were a big deal in terms of selling product, in terms of that's where people would hang out.
Half a sip and a soda, we got a scheme. Somebody else plays the record machine. It's so easy to say pet names when you listen to the trumpet of Harry James. Hey!
Kids now don't know that in the record store is, but that was sort of the meeting place of where people talked about music, bought music. It was the whole epicenter of where music sort of exploded out. So I always thought, well, put this on the racks on the wall and it's going to gain some attention. And sure enough, I believe that cover got people's attention.
When the album cover showed up, which was totally fucking Gregg. Gregg is the guy who brainstormed the album cover. He's the movie guy, Monster Pierce, Los Blancas. Here's the story put over in the band, and we believed it, because we were like dumbass, you know, Arkies and punk rock motherfuckers, and Todd, you know, if he forgot to tell you, Todd went to high school with Sean Cassidy, man. Beverly Hills High School up on the Coldwater Canyon Boulevard. And Todd's response to that was to drop LSD and crawl around the sewers now and then, and the only rock music that he claims he was into was Alice Cooper Band, which is pretty fucking cool. So When that album cover showed up, not having any idea what our album cover was like, I went, holy shit, this is amazing. And PJ's there. Gregg explained to us, we threw airplanes on there to make PJ happy, but it's hilarious because there really aren't very many airplanes, you know, fighting combat missions in 1852 when this movie is shot. But PJ's not going to figure this out. He's going to be like, ah, everybody's, yeah. He's like, big aviation fan. That's a good album cover.
Mike was actually off by 107 years. The film was actually shot in 1959. Now here is Jeff Dahl with a little bit of Angry Samoans trivia, and then you will hear a song called Are You Square, which will make more sense after you hear what Jeff Dahl has to say about Back from Samoa and Return to Samoa.
Back to Samoa was actually recorded with me on vocal before Metal Mike rejoined the band. You know, we recorded it up in Mill Valley. We recorded pretty much the whole thing. There are actually two tunes, I think, on it we recorded that didn't make the album. Because when I quit and Mike rejoined the band, they felt kind of rightly that Mike had been part of this and was going to be part of it again. It written some of these songs that they should take the tapes and record his vocals over it, scratch my vocals. And I don't have any bad feelings about that at all. I mean, I completely understand why they would do that. It didn't bother me at all. And there is an old bootleg of it, the Jeff sessions, the original sessions. It's called Return to Samoa.
Jeff, tell us about your departure from the Angry Samoans.
I loved being in that band. It was one of the coolest things ever. I remember vividly the first rehearsal that I had done with them, actually the audition. The power these guys had behind me that was just like, wow, you know, this is a real band here. First show I did with the Samoans was December 2nd, 1980 at a place called Joey Kills out in Burbank. And the last show I did with them was June 20th, 1981, at a place called Stage One, basically 7-8 months. Yeah, I loved it and everything, but kind of wanting to do my own stuff, you know. I always wanted to be a songwriter, and it was kind of my main motivation for getting into music in the first place. She's the kind of girl that I really adore. She grabbed my attention like no one before. I had a bunch of songs, and there's no way that they were going to get recorded or played by the Samoans for at least another year or so. So there were a couple frictions with one of the guys, Todd, you know, a little bit. He's kind of a nuanced guy, but I love him, and he's really one of the most incredible bass players ever. And, you know, I just kind of wanted to change. And so I just talked with Gregg and said, Gregg, you know, I'm one time go up and do my own thing. I said, well, it's a bummer, but, you know, I understand. That was it. I've heard a couple of people say, oh, you were fired. But no, that's not true. It was all good. It was all good. And I had nothing but good memories of all those guys and being in Samoa and singing and playing those songs. Those first two albums, I mean, they're just loaded with some of the best songs you could ever possibly imagine. The seminal 70s, early 80s punk rock scene, they really set the standard.
Jeff Dahl's first gig is New Year's Eve, 1980, Fear, Circle Jerks, Angry Samoans. They play a bunch of gigs, about a dozen gigs, give or take, counting Northern California, between then and July 4th, 81. Dahl disappears. According to Jeff, quote, I quit going to band practice. At the end of the year, December, there was one last gig, 5 months later, in December, with Dahl. And witnesses say Todd got in a fight with a band friend. And that was the last gig Jeff ever played at the band. And so the phone call to me came into the pipeline after that point. The band was dead in the water for 5 months, no gigs. They play one gig, and I think he was run out of the band as much as he quit. It was a mutual thing. Todd versus Jeff or Jeff versus Todd, you're not going to get the same story.
I went to see Ian Hunter play once, and I was introduced to the guy who was playing bass in Concrete Blonde. Started talking to him, and you know, the guy I was with said, oh, he was in the Angry Samoans. He said, oh, man, I know you. You're a fucking dick, man. And I said, really, why? And he said, well, you know, when I was a little kid, me and my friend up in Seattle, Duff McKagan, we're like the biggest Angry Samoans fans. We wrote you guys a fan letter. you answered us back by writing back on a piece of toilet paper and asking for nude pictures of our mom. I remember doing that in a spot, like sitting around thinking of ways to be obnoxious. It's going to come back and bite you in the ass.
Track number 10, Tuna Taco, was written by Todd Homer, but he artfully dodged talking about this song in our interview. So here is Todd Homer talking about his last days in the band.
Well, I left the band in 88 to the month, 10 years to the month since I had joined it. I was the youngest. I was the only teenager in the band in the beginning. I was 18 years old. I was 28 years old in 1988. I decided I'd had enough. I didn't want to be a punk rocker as I got older. I look back and I'm glad. I see a lot of guys around L.A. that are my age, that are in their 50s, have got tattoos, and they're still trying to play punk rock, you know? I never went in for any of that shit. That's one thing about the band that I really admired it. There was no posing, there was no posturing in the Angry Samoans. There wasn't grasping of trends per se. Like, you never saw anybody in the band wearing tattoos or mohawks or chains or, you know, none of that crap. And there was just too much infighting. And, you know, Mike was living in Oakland. The rest of the band was still in the L.A. County area. Yeah, he was all the way in Oakland. It was always a pain in the ass. I was usually the guy who'd pick him up from the airport, or nobody wanted to put him up, and Mike wouldn't pay for a hotel, so he'd stay with me. That was always a little bit of a strain, but I don't have any ill will toward Mike, you know, or anybody in the band to this day, today, but Mike was eccentric, to say the least. Far more than anybody else in the group. It wasn't always difficult. He wasn't always easy to get along with, sometimes even difficult. But I always looked up to Mike. I always admired him. He was the major creative force in the band. He was the best songwriter in the band by far. And it's because he was so meticulous about the way things sounded and the way that things were performed that helped a lot to fine-tune the sound we ended up with on records.
Before track number 11, Coffin Case, you will hear from first Billy, then Todd, and Mike talking a little bit about Angry Samoans and touring. And then you will hear from Gregg about track number 11, Coffin Case.
When reflecting on touring in the late 80s, I find myself saying things like an old man. I remember when we didn't have cell phones, we had to carry a shitload of quarters around with us. Angry Samoans were at the forefront of hardcore punk touring. What was that like? Do you remember your first tours and any of, like, old man feelings of, we used to have to, blah, blah, blah?
Yeah, it was the West Coast. We didn't really tour that much. We went to San Francisco, played a few shows, came back. But then we went to the East Coast. You know, we only had a few weeks because everybody worked. We only had, like, a week's vacation or, you know, pretty early on in their careers. So we only did, like, a little short. But it was really cool. We were, like, the house band, the Mud Club, just playing same place for a week in New York. And that was, like, a big deal. Then sometimes we would go New York, Boston, we'd probably play in Philadelphia, real short like that, 1 week, go back, hang out for a couple of days, come right back. We weren't really like a big touring band. We didn't start really touring until way later. We didn't go to Europe until like 98, I think.
That's 20 years being a band. What was that mostly? Was it due to just everyone's schedules?
Yeah, I'd do schedules. Mikey's a CPA, so he couldn't leave his work. Turner was going to school, you know, and doing his job that he did. He got married, and all kinds of crazy stuff went on.
With that type of interspersed touring, did you actually have a tour van, or did you, like you were saying, mostly fly to places?
Yeah, we'd fly out, and then we'd have like a road manager guy out there with a van, and we'd rent the equipment. Probably a lot of guys did that in those days. They'd have a van, they'd have equipment, so they'd be like the whole package, and we'd stay where we could stay. We'd stay at people's houses sometimes, or at the promoter's house, or somewhere like that, you know, sleep on floors. Very rarely we'd stay at hotels and stuff like that.
Yeah, our MO was usually to fly into a town and get a rental van and a town car, fill the van with some rental equipment, or have some rental company drop off equipment at each show as we got there. And then we wouldn't need the rental van, just one Lincoln Town Car. We could squeeze everybody in it and then go from city to city, all up and down the eastern seaboard. In 81, there was a guy who was booking for us. And we even spent a night sleeping on his floor, and then he sent us to some other guy's apartment to sleep, and some poor guy that was out of town didn't know he had a rock band staying in his apartment. The first time we went to San Francisco, he slept on Jello Biafra's floor. Minus Gregg. Gregg always dug into his pockets and got, you know, himself in a hotel room. It was a little bit of an elitist, you know. He'd want some privacy, some peace and quiet, I guess. Mike was nuts, but the rest of the guys, you know, Gregg was a little bit of a separatist, and the rest of the guys were just young kids, you know, just having fun and want to get fucked up at night, get drunk, and, you know, maybe scout for some chicks or something like that. So
after we had sold 50,000 copies as a benchmark, which took a few years, they not only increased our royalty rate to what the majors would call a mid-level rate, like a major label band that could sell 300,000, 4,000 records but not quite go gold would get a mid-level rate, and they applied it retroactively to the entire 50,000 units sold that were full albums at a full $1.50 back from Samoa. And Into My Brain full album got a full $1.50 retro-fucking-actively. That was thousands of dollars. We're talking four figures here, dude. I'm counting my fingers. I have four fingers. We're getting paid. You know, like in a small-time band, when you get paid $1,000 or more, it's good. You fly out, borrow all the equipment from downtown Brown, you play 8 gigs, and get paid $10,000, $11,000, you know, out of state, Midwest, East Coast, for 8 gigs. You come back, your band might have cleared $5,000 out of 10 after paying the booker is 10%, because you're smart, and all you did is rent a luxury car. You rented a Ford Taurus or better and drove around like slackers on vacation, listened to football on the radio, and you got your T-shirts in the trunk, and you know, you borrow all the equipment. You take your own guitars because you are professional that way. So we got out to the East Coast 3 times. It burned the entire long, quote, long vacation, you know, 8 work days, 2 entire weekends possible. And the band, either lineup, the Stevie lineup and the PJ lineup, man, all 5 guys would say the same thing. All 5 guys would say being in the same car or 2 cars split with those 4 guys, man, hand me the gun so I can kill myself before I kill them. I'm going to kill them, then kill myself. Just get me the fuck out of here. That's what made it a punk rock band. That's what made it authentic California punk rock.
Coffin Case was sort of a throwaway that we just added on. Mike was fooling around with some stuff and decided he fell in love with this sort of toss-off that we did at the last second. There wasn't too much to that.
Here is the last piece by PJ Galligan, plus a eulogy he wrote for himself before passing away.
First gigs plural? Not so much. First gigs singular? Yeah, because it didn't happen. If memory serves, we were supposed to play some punkoid dive on a weekend afternoon. Metal Mike had given me money to go get a haircut. My hair length was apparently unacceptable. But the thing I was edgy about was that these guys always seemed to be in bad moods or full of themselves or something I didn't get, and I wasn't sure how my playing would go over in public. It looked like we got to the gig early to load in, and Metal Mike sat on the curb eating peanut butter straight out of a jar with his finger. After a time, it became clear that the gig had been canceled, and nobody had had the decency to inform us. That was my first non-gig with the Samoans. Patrick P.J. Galligan died on May 1st, 2014, of factors resulting from his multi-year ordeal with cancer. Loved by a few, liked by many, and undoubtedly despised by many more, P.J.'s life was filled with the many activities he undertook that would result in a wide range of reactions and sentiments from others, which was fine by him. Though he loved his life and had a great deal of fun living it, he also felt, as the lyric from The Who's My Generation, I hope I die before I get old. So, as things turned out, he actually did, and prior to his passing, received a measure of satisfaction from this circumstance.
Hope I die before I get old. Talking about my generation. Try and dig what we all say.
There's a song in particular that I thought we could launch into talking maybe about the queer appeals, because Stupid Jerk is on that EP. So I was thinking maybe we could use that song as a moment to talk about why you released something as a queer appeals in between being the Angry Samoans. So,
well, it's a little hazy, but my recollection is that there is this studio in Hollywood called Mystic Sound that had done a number of local punk stuff in Hollywood. The Back from Samoa was just taking long, long time to get out. I mean, initially when we recorded it, Saunders wasn't in the band, Jeff Dahl was. So we proceeded recording the record and thinking we're going to put it out with Jeff as a permanent member. I mean, when Jeff was a part of the band for about a year, there was never any sense that Mike was coming back at that point. Anyway, things morphed until in the sense that Saunders did come back eventually, but all the changes and time that was put into Back from Samoa reflected the fact that the lineup of the band was changing and evolving, and we didn't know where we were going, and it just took forever to put the damn thing out. And so Todd, I believe, and myself to some degree, were getting impatient, and we thought it'd be fun to go into this little studio in Hollywood and record some stuff and see what happens. And I think Time to Fuck was on this Queer Pills EP.
Time to hate, time to kill, time to run, it's time to fuck, time to eat, time to fall, time to run your fucking head to wall.
Yeah, Time to Fuck was one of the stellar anthems that we wrote. That was never released on anything. So we recorded that and decided, you know, we had some fun doing it and decided we might as well, you know, while we're waiting for the other one to come out, put this out real quick. And then someone had the brainstorm, well, if we give it a title other than the Angry Samoan, that would be sort of funny, but in addition, maybe we can trick Rodney into playing it and he wouldn't have any clues to who it was. And from what I understand, when we pressed a number of those, it almost happened. I mean, someone delivered it to him in the station and he didn't have a clue until the very last second when someone phoned him up with a tip.
Track number 12, You Stupid Jerk, written by Mike Saunders, clocks in as the shortest song on the record at 23 seconds. Here is Mike discussing the shortness of the Angry Samoan songs.
At the Mab, you go play a huge gig, it's the third band, you got 30 minutes, period. And Dirk would be staring through with a stopwatch like, you're gone. It's now 11 o'clock, you started at 10:30 and you were gone at 11. It's 20 songs, and Gregg Turner hand wrote the time, so we must have been using the old General Mills stopwatch, because no one else had a stopwatch to time, you know, minutes and seconds, up to 3 minutes. 20 songs in 26 minutes, and this is the final evolution of our 9 months with PJ, September 80, or practicing in August, then gigging, starting gigging in September, out through the next June. And it was out of the same ballpark as Black Flag, The Crowd, and Red Cross. We're talking some seriously short songs. All four bands, you know, executing their idea in different ways. Gregg Turner is half correct when he says, when Dahl got in the band, they started playing faster. But, dude, the faster and shorter was in place, and you fucking wrote out the minutes and seconds of every single song with my felt pen.
Jeff, both Gregg and even Mike had to admit that having you in the band increased the energy and the speed of Angry Samoans. Do you find that to be true?
Yeah, that is absolutely true. Before I joined, the Samoans were kind of a band that would sort of stand on stage and didn't move much, you know. And they played incredibly, yeah. But that was kind of their thing, is they just kind of stood there and heads down, blew through their songs. When I was in Samoans, we never did a set that was really over about 30 minutes, except jamming with the Circle Jerks until daybreak. But that was just kind of, I was a big Stooges fan and MC5, and I liked a lot of those bands that, you know, had a front man that's just all over the place. So, you know, that was just a natural thing to do. And, yeah, the Samoans, the guys in the band said, yeah, go crazy, be obnoxious. boy, the injury list, I broke my tailbone, I broke my hand, bit off a piece of my tongue. All sorts of fun things happened. And that's just like being in the band 6-7 months, you know?
Track number 13, Ballad of Jerry Curlin.
So Todd and I were at my house, my parents' house, and there was a Jim Jones movie on TV, and it's a high point in the movie. Powers Booth, the B actor that played Jim Jones, was telling people to drink the Kool-Aid. Drink the Kool-Aid. Drink the Kool-Aid. It'll be good for you, you know. And Todd and I were rolling on the ground laughing. For some reason, I can't figure out now, but it seemed funny at the time. And my mom was sitting in the other room. She says, "What's so funny?" And I said, "Oh, there's just a mass suicide going on TV." And she goes, "Why does that make you so happy?" I said, "Well, it's funny. It's you know, people are drinking Kool-Aid." I said, "What's your objection to her?" She said, "Well, why can't you be aesthetic? Why can't you like the nice things about life that your brother, younger brother's little friend, Jerry Curlin, likes?" I said, "What's that?" And I took out her notepad. She goes, "Well, he's a Senate page in Washington. He's aesthetic. He likes meeting people. He's a very social type." I said, "Wait, don't go fast. Hold on." And I start writing this down. And then it was just natural, as that was the verse, to put, "Drinks toilet water, you know, sucks horsey dick, you know, whatever." And then I said, "Now, what is it else you like about Jerry Curlin?" "Well, he's a very sensitive type. He likes meeting people." I said, "Hold on." And so that's from her mouth is what you hear on the record. And, and then Todd and I just rabbit hyenas with what would add the other parts to it. And that was Jerry Curlin.
Gregg, when and why was it time for you to leave the Angry Samoans?
So the last show we played was the official last show we played. Well, first of all, Todd, who was one of the original guiding lights that we had from day one, Mike and I put the band together, but Todd was close after that, and it was a lot of his impetus and a lot of his contributions that made it what it was in the beginning. And so he left in 1988, I believe, or 89, because he was smart. I mean, things were starting to really stagnate, and the antipathy and angst in the band with each other was just getting so palpable and so unruly. Painful, I mean, more than it ever used to be. Wisely, he chose to sort of, at that point, exit. And so then we were down to a four-piece. We sort of hacked it on for another 2 years. And we'd always play pretty much the same set because Mike lived up in Oakland. We were down in Southern California, so we didn't have a lot of quality time to rehearse new stuff. So it was again, playing the same set over and over. But that was pretty much it. So it really got to be to a point where it was just too much. I was finishing my degree in graduate school. This was 1991 at the Club Lingerie. It was the last show. I mean, there was all sorts of reasons. Mike got into an accident. It wasn't horrible, but demanded reimbursement from everybody. Billy, the drummer, who always was at loggerheads with Mike over finances, so that's it, I can't take it anymore. And it was pretty much it. We were all content to sort of let it, you know, we've gone beyond the shelf life of what the band should have had to begin with. You know, let's leave it at that. And so that it was left at that. The band was sort of on the shelf. And then I think in 94, 95, Saunders couldn't resist resurrecting. Apparently recruited some Confederate members. And, you know, there's the next phase, if you call it that. Somewhere in the last 5 or 6 years, maybe longer, I don't know, you'd have to ask Billy, he came on board. And so they hack at it now. You know, to me, it's nuts. I mean, I've seen videos of them play, and it's sort of like, you know, it almost looks like a parody of what it used to be. Jerry Curlin and Get Off the Air and all that worked because it was a point in time and how old we were at the time that we could deliver the message in the right context, and that kind of idiocy and that kind of sort of celebration of being knuckleheads worked. I mean, as adults, honestly, trying to sell that to the next generation of kids, I mean, if that's who shows up, it's beyond what I can fathom.
Here is drummer Bill, not as a complaint, but as an afterthought.
But I helped write one song, but they stopped putting credit, which was Jerry Curlin. That song a little bit, but it's on the German import, but it's not on any of the American ones. And it's really funny because I tell people that we happen to play this place in Oregon called Plan B, and they had a bar there, you know, the bar, and someone had put their old punk records in it and then resined over it with fiberglass to make it look clear and so you can't touch them. And they actually had the German back from Samoa there, and they had the Jerry Curlin had said, you know, that they gave me credit for it. The ones in the States, I never even realized that they put my name on it, which I didn't care.
Track number 14 is Not of This Earth.
This killer is a fiend of the most diabolical kind.
13.
Maybe more. He's looking for only one thing. Blood.
Human victims for human blood. Experiment in horror to satisfy a desperate need never before known. A need that was not of this earth.
So that was a Roger Corman movie. I think it was 1959, maybe. If you've never seen it, you should check it out. It's incredible. I mean, there's various versions of it. Tracy Lords was in one later incarnation of it that Corman did. So it's about this alien that looks like a insurance salesman with a bad hat and Lou Reed wraparound shades. And he would go around, he was on Earth trying to get blood for his planet. So he'd carry around this briefcase and he would hypnotize people. And if they looked into his eyes, they would pass out on the ground. Then he'd open up this attaché case and siphon blood out of them and put it in milk bottles to transport back to his dying planet. And it was just sublime. I mean, that's the line in the song where Mike screams, "I'll put your head in a milk bottle." That's where it came from.
What has kept you involved with Angry Samoans? I'm sure with long extended breaks in between, but for over 35 years, 36, as you say.
Believe it or not, it's so funny. I'm a fan. I like the songs. So they're fun to play. You know, I have a lot of fun. I've been playing them all the time. But which was really weird and still happens today is I get my drum set and I got a different bass player, got a different guitar player. We have a group of guys that go touring with us. Then, you know, sometimes we have guys that just do the local shows and they sit back there and everybody's always on. And I'm trying to get these band, you know, people in, you know, trying to get another bass player for this tour and trying to get a guitar player because our guitar player has to work or use up all his vacation times. It gets crazy, but the reason why I stay in the band so long is I really have fun playing songs.
Being in a distant land.
And it seems as you were saying in the beginning, you were more not the voyeur, but you were the drummer who sat back. And now it seems with you and Mike as the long-standing members, you are more forced into working out details.
I look up, there's a hole in my hand, and it really hurts.
Yeah, now I mostly just let Mike know where the shows are, or the booking agent will. And he shows up to the gigs because he can't rehearse with us because he still lives in, you know, up north, Oakland area. And I live down here in Southern California. And that's where the bass player and the guitar player live. So we rehearse, you know, still like the old days, you know. And then we get to show him. There's Mikey. Mikey shows up. Could be anywhere, you know. He'll show up in Germany. He'll show up in Las Vegas. Sometimes he'll show up at my house. We'll go together.
One of the reasons I started this podcast is because I wanted to get the voices of the drummers and members that don't usually speak out.
Now I have to sing because at one point we start running out of singers. So then me and Mike are like, what are we going to do? And then he wanted to play the drums. And so then I go, what am I going to do while you play? He goes, well, you could go get a beer or stand to the side. I go, what are you talking about? So I started up front singing a couple songs, you know. Then I got better at imitating him. And I took some songs from him. I took some songs that Todd used to sing. I do parts, you know, that Gregg used to sing. I think I sing like four less songs than Mike does.
Okay. So I'm doing is I'm going to say wrong about 10 different times. You can use your favorite one or two if you need to correct any gregariously wrong. Gregg just calls a flat out wrong year. Don't ask about time or place. Literally, he got Vom's first gig, quote unquote, off by 2 years on the calendar. 76. It's in an interview in print. I do not arrive in L.A. till May 77th. That's quite a feat. Mass PhD, lifetime accountant. So I'm the printed matter guy and the fact checker. Well, actually, being a record reviewer and all that in college and later on for Chuck Eddy at The Voice, you become a mega fact checker. You become a wannabe Lenny Kaye. He was my favorite guy. He was like a combination of record collector and a big fan and historian. Hell, he got to do a bio on Waylon Jennings, sort of, you know, write real books and shit. As well as play bad riffs in the Patti Smith Band. Okay, so I'm rolling tape. Wrong. No, dude. Wrong. Oh, my God. That is so wrong. 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 No. Wrong. No, that's fucking wrong. What the fuck? No. Wrong. 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 Wrong.
Stupid jerk! I can't take it no more! Your face makes me wanna puke! And your mother's a whore! No! You stupid jerk!
You have just completed the unabridged 13th episode of the Angry Samoans Back from Samoa. Keep an eye out for the next two podcasts, including an all-writers episode of The Pogues, Rum, Sodomy, and The Lash. And quick on its heels will be an episode dedicated to lookout band Crimp Shrine, with a plethora of individual interviews of band members. Lastly, I'd like to thank my new assistant audio editor, Jason Bro. Jason Bro is the voice behind the 6-Foot-Plus podcast, a showcase of the creepy side of music, found online at 6ftpplus.com. Thank you, and good of the bye.
John's got a problem, and he's out of control. John's got a problem, and he's out of control now.
Thank you for listening to Jughead's Basement here on the all-new JughedsBasement.com. If you'd like to help keep Jughead's Basement free every month, click the donate button and give as much or as little as you can. The show is also available on iTunes, so take a moment and write us a review. We'll see you next month.